Good morning, everyone. I thank the organizers for inviting me for this very important conference, and I'm very glad that this is such an African conference with a lot of African contributions. What I want to talk about is on what does open access do for us, for the developing world and for the North also. And I want to talk about how can we achieve open access. First, I show this slide. This is a slide provided by Cameron Nealon, which you can put in any presentation so that people know that they can use this presentation, reuse it, etc. You can find the information afterwards. So the overview of my talk is that I will first talk about the definition of open access that I use and that a group of open access advocacy people is using. Then I will compare the open access and the tall access publishers and have something to say about the cost of open access. Many of the other speakers have touched this subject. Then I will go to the effects of open access on several areas, and then to how can we get open access? What actually do we have to do, like the previous speaker has said? What are we going to do when we come from this conference? And then I have a brief talk about scientists, communities, and tools that you can use in research and in working with databases, etc. So first I say the definition that I use and that many people use is the definition of the Budapest Convention. And that one has been updated very recently this year. And it talks about open access to journal articles and also to data. And it's important to stress this point because there are many people who just pose any definition of open access, and I think we should stick to this definition in all that we do with open access. And in addition, we strongly, and we is then the group that I work for at the Open Knowledge Foundation, which is the open access initiative of the Open Access of the Open Knowledge Foundation. We really strongly recommend using the Creative Commons licenses, CC BY, for journal articles and CC 0 for the data. So who needs access? And the answer is very simple. All these people standing there need access to information. Every human being needs access to information. Not only scientists, that is another important point. We scientists are working with information, but all people need information on many subjects, and most notably, of course, on the subject of medicine and health. And, well, they can't get the access because there are tall access publishers that publish the articles so that you don't see it. And if you introduce open access, it has been found that over 40% of the new readers of the articles in question are really from outside the academia, which is a very important point, I think. Well, we have had a survey on the subject of who wants open access. We did a survey with the Malaria World website, and the readers are 8,000 people involved with malaria research. They are nurses, scientists, people interested in malaria, people, patients, everybody. And there are some interesting results of this survey. For example, they say, "Our management discourages us from supporting new open access journals due to their low or unassigned impact factor." Another subject that we have seen in this conference. Or At my university, the department only paid publication fees for persons with a permanent position. So the rest of us have to find the money somehow, or bribe a professor. And that is real reactions on the website of the survey that we conducted on the subject of open access. Who needs open access? Why do we need it? What do you want to do with it? More than three quarters of researchers based in the developing world think that open access, that access to information, not having it, is unethical, from the same survey. So the survey results in brief are that 95% of the respondents agreed to the statement that articles on malaria should be available free. And only 2% never had any problems with access. And that includes, of course, the technical problems in Africa and other developing areas. You can see that in Africa, South America, and Asia, 40, 80, and 90% respectively claimed never to use Hinawi or did not even know about its existence. Another remarkable outcome of this survey. So what is restrictive publishing? Well, restrictive publishing is about cost and benefit. So we know, for example, that the publisher that has been in the news most, Elsevier, is making a profit of 37% on his businesses, mainly on journal publishing. And the user, the one that reads, that publishes the papers and has to read it, he has to transfer the copyrights. He has only a right to read, but you cannot use it. And if it's in a toll access paper, journal, then you have to pay per view, for example. One important point here is that the transfer of copyrights has only been implied since 1998 for the digital content. So everybody who has published before 1998 can just scan his article that he published and put it on the internet or wherever, and he's perfectly in the clear, legally. Only after 1998 have the publishers asked from their authors to sign agreements for digital content. So purchase, short-term access, for example, pay-per-view, you have to pay $10 or more per article. Now about another point. Open access publishing and toll access publishing. The difference in costs. There has been studies that open access articles, well, we take as a point now the the cost for the articles of the cross, which is over 1,000 an article. But the toll access articles will cost over 5,000 for an article. Eventually, the costs of the open access articles can go down as low as 250, is what people tell me. And in that case, open access publishing will be 20 times cheaper than toll access publishing. And we talk about a total of $16 billion. And there is a budget for science of $300 billion. So it means that the publishing will cost 5% of the total budget and can go down to 1/20th of the 5%. Ross Mounts, who is at the University of Bath in England, and is also in this open access group that I mentioned, made a plot on the cost of open access journals. And also, so you see on the y-axis, there is the license, the CC BY, the CC BY NC, or other kinds of licenses. You can find it on the internet, just looking for the Mounts plot. And it's a nice overview of the broad range of costs for open access journals. You can just have the links afterwards. So the cost of open access. Somehow, somewhere, someone going to pay, because it's not for nothing. And who pays? Well, in my view, less than 1% of the current science funding will easily cover the cost of open access publishing, if everything will be open access. The funders and libraries are now paying 5% on a total budget of 300 million. So if you could somehow divert these sums of money into the publishing of open access articles, that wouldn't be a problem. Perhaps it's too simplistic, but that's one for the discussion. Is open access sustainable? Several studies are there that show that open access benefits outweigh the costs by a factor of 5 or more. There has been a study of the National Health in the States, the United States, where they stated these figures. And there have been a number of studies by Horton and Swen and also Brams who have investigated what this cost-benefit ratio is for open access. And the benefits always outweigh the cost more than 5 times. You can read it up. Very detailed articles. So let's now go to the effects of open access. I think open access has an effect on very many areas of science. Open science, it will lead to open science, it will lead to open education. Everybody has access to education and everybody has access to the results of science. It has also political effects, because if citizens have access to data that the government supplies, open access, then you have informed citizens. It can have a very important effect for the countries in the developing world. Economic effects, well, other speakers also have said it, very well known, if you have access to information, then you have knowledge, and knowledge is power. And knowledge is also what generates economic growth and prosperity and innovation. And as long as all this knowledge is kept locked behind bars, then you cannot access it. And only the ones that pay for it can access and grow and be rich. Open access, another effect is that it improves the quality of science, in my view. And it also enables new ways of measuring the impact, the real impact of science. Because if articles and data are open access, are available to anyone, then everybody can read the articles and give his opinion on it. And if you only can read an abstract or a title, then you cannot judge what the article is or what the data are. So you open up an enormous potential of reviewers, the readers, the students, everybody, who can just really take part in the judging of the quality of the articles. And you can also, which is very important, take into consideration all these areas that are not science, but they are touched by having access to information. Social areas, business areas, everything. And how does open access improve the quality of science, what I just said? Well, because it prevents fraud. Because if everybody can read the real data and can see the real articles, then it's very difficult for authors to to mislead everybody who reads it. There will be always someone who will spot something that is wrong. And open data also prevents tampering, because if some people are going to look at the data, there will be some amongst them who will see that there is something wrong with this data, or not. And if you only have a couple of people who have access to those data, nobody will ever know if something's wrong with it. And open access also enables new forms of collaboration and discovery. And open access enables citizen science, which is citizens having certain questions and problems that they pose, and they can find information to solve their problems. There has been a very, very good book about new forms of collaboration and doing science by Michael Nielsen, Reinventing Discovery. And I would suggest anybody who is interested to read these ideas. Now I come to another topic that has been touched in this conference already. The impact factor is a main obstruction to open access. That is a statement that I really want to make. And for instance, Ethan Perlstein, a scientist in the United States, he says the current publishing model exploits scientists' addiction to the impact factor. It's almost an addiction. There is method on open access, and then there is getting clean. Scientists are hesitant to publish in open access journals because employers look at the impact factor. Stephen Curry also mentioned in this conference, I'm sick of the impact factors. And Björn Brems, who says, well, how to get rid of it. There are main problems with the soundness of the impact factor. The impact factor is something that is negotiable, something that is irreproducible, and something that is mathematically unsound. All statements made by Björn Brems in many of his articles. And how can we understand this? Well, negotiable will say, if you know that the impact factor is the number of citations in 1 year, for articles that have been published in 1 year, for articles that have been published 2 years before, then the number of those articles that you take into consideration is influencing the impact factor. And that what happens often is that people, or the ones that are interested in these results, what they say is, well, this is not an article, and that is only a comment, and this is only this, and this is only that. So if you take out half of the articles, so-called articles, then the impact factor can change enormously. That is one thing that you can do. Mathematically unsound is also a thing that is important, because the impact factor is not really saying something about the quality of the individual articles. It says something about the quality of a journal. But then it's an average quality. So you can say this is a good journal, and every scientist having experience with this area of expertise, for example, infectious disease, will say this is a good journal. Journal of Infectious Disease is a good journal. That's subjective, but it's true. And the impact factor also says, yeah, this is a good journal. But you cannot say the other way around. Every article published in that journal is a good quality article. Because if you have an article that is cited 7,000 times, and there are the half of the articles is cited less than 2 times, then still you have a lot of citations. So it's mathematically unsound. And what we really should do is not leave the impact factor altogether. We should keep the citation part of it. And then we could put to it the usage, the peer review, and the old metrics. In a recent conference that I had in Rotterdam 2 weeks ago, we were talking, and when we don't have the impact factor, we still need some quality measure because open access journals don't have any impact factor yet. Most of them that are very young have not published very much, so you cannot calculate anything with it. So what can you do? You can look at the quality of the editorial board, or you can look at the quality of the peer review, and that is what we have done. We have compared the quality of the editorial board, the citation indices of the editorial board members and other indicators, and the transparency of the peer review process. How good is the peer review for the open access article? And that gave very, very nice results. Let me just skip this one. This one too. I've talked about it. Yeah, this is an important one. Open access against scientific fraud. Especially medical research is unacceptable, I think. Pharmaceutical companies can hide the results for medicines because they do selective publishing. Side effects are often not published. And the result is that many people suffer from bad medicines and even from unnecessary treatments. And there is now a case in the UK going on against GlaxoSmithKline for the grip, influenza medicine. That there is something like this is the matter with it. One of the last effects of open access, open education. Open education enables higher education for all through the internet. The level of education will rise rapidly. There is more education, more economical and social development. So open education is another important effect of the open access. This is the conference. So I now go to how to get open access. Well, I think scientists hold the power in their own hand. Because if you say, yeah, I have to publish there because my boss says I have to publish there, otherwise I don't get promotion. In fact, everybody does have the power in his own hand to publish where he wants. And if you are many and you say, we want to publish open access, then you can pull it off. But what is necessary is an attitude change. And what is necessary is a coordination of the scientists' networked communities and the structured information, especially. The change in attitude, you can say, that it is really reflected by when I light my candle from yours, I gain from you without subtracting from you. And that is what sharing knowledge is like. Open access is all about getting new ideas by sharing. Collaboration, publish for impact, for real impact, for effect. Focus on quality. And tall access is fear of losing ideas. But when I put it in the open, the idea is gone. Competition, a lot of competition is going on. Publish or perish is the one that is with open access. That is, you need to publish as much in high impact journals. So it's about quantity and not quality. So we need coordination for open access. That is what we need to do. The open access movement is fragmented because many people are using different definitions. There is no consensus on what open access is. There is not one single thing. No consensus on the best form of open access publishing. Need to build communities with common ideas, because then you can organize the information. And somebody needs to coordinate these communities of scientists and scientific information, which could be anything, but it could also be the Open Knowledge Foundation, perhaps. Or there is another organization, Open Webware, which I can talk in the discussion. Access alone is not enough. We need to organize the information. If you really have access to everything, what happens? Well, you have all kinds of informations coming from everywhere, and you get fragmentation and lack of focus. Where do you find what? And that is the problem of information overload. Too much to know, too big to know, which is a book by Weinberg, who writes about this problem and says, well, what you have to do is organize. And that organization could be done in focused communities, I think. Focused communities, communities of scientists who focus on a certain subject. And now I talk about my own experience with the malaria community. So if you have Malaria World, for example, or you have Patients Like Me, which is a community, eCancer.org, My Science Work, is also a community, Research Gate, and African networks like IR Africa Info. Those are communities for people who want open access and want to do something with the information. And what they can do is make that information in their area available to everybody, be a source of information for everybody. And I think that Malaria World, if you have a look at the website of Malaria World, that is a model for how you can have an open access community organizing the malaria information so that everybody can access it. They provide links to the full text articles. So those communities, what they can do is organize data, publications, development of tools, reference managing, like you have with Mendeley. And the people that can work with them, with those communities that I'm talking about, is, for example, scientific libraries, open access publishers, PubMed Central or EU Open Air, World Bank, can all get together and trying to pull off such a structure that I just proposed to put into place to have organized information and to have usable information. So now I come to the last part of my talk, which is, what are the tools that you can use for an open access environment? There is the need to have bibliographic tools, because you have articles or information and you need to organize it in such a way that you could link to data sets, you could link to other databases, to repositories, whatever. And the Open Knowledge Foundation has developed a program, a software program, BIPSU, which does just that. It can provide links to all kinds of articles, and we have made a version that links all data on malaria. And not for every year that has been gone since 1880, but we will have it at some time. So the goal is to have every bit of information on malaria sitting in a database that is accessible to everybody, and that will provide full text links, and all the data will be have to be available in a data hub and a wiki. Then we have to measure the quality of the information. We can use old metrics, we can use the reputation index, and we can use something like A Factor. I can briefly say the reputation index. If you have a new kind of impact factor, an impact factor which doesn't only mean having citations, but it also takes into consideration all the other effects in the areas outside of science, then you can go from this journal level metrics to the scientist. What did the scientist publish? And what was his impact in society and in the scientific community, etc.? And that is a new sort of impact for the scientist, which I would call reputation index. And you can also find articles describing this kind of ID for judging scientists, not by saying in what journals did he publish and how much. No, what was his impact with his articles or his blogs or whatever in society and in the scientific community? And that can be possibly stated in kind of a reputation index. And then the A factor is a means to judge the quality of open access journals that we have studied in the conference 2 weeks ago in Rotterdam. And then we could need to find out how much is open access in the real world. What do we have in open access? Because especially, for example, for malaria, you can go to all malaria articles, and then you can find out how much of it is open access, is available to everybody. And of course, it should be 100%. Because then everybody can do everything with it. But if it's only 40%, then 60% is it. And it should be made available sometime. That is the aim that the Malaria World website and group will have, to make everything available. So what we can use is the BIPSOUP database server. And what it does is, for example, it can give a graphical representation of the types of licenses in the malaria database. And the malaria database can be found on the internet. And you can see that most of the big blue circle is most of the articles don't carry a Creative Commons license. So you don't know what you can do with it. Can you use it? Can you reuse it? That should change. And that is an easy representation in the bibliography. The right side of the picture shows the representation of the most cited articles in the malaria database, centered in the bigger blue circles. And the most cited article in the case of malaria is a Nature article in 2005 that we found. But if we have a more complete database, we can pick out the one that is really the most cited and what are the most important, perhaps, articles. And then what we have developed is an open access index. An open access index is an index that states the percentage of articles on malaria in any given journal that is open access. And it also can state the percentage of the total of open access malaria articles that are available in the world that one journal publishes, which is the GJ2. And if you look at this figure, you can see that the ones that are most prominent are the PLOS One in the brown, and the Malaria Journal, which is the blue one, has the highest open access index. It means it has most of the open access malaria articles. So I think I just end with this. The future is now, if we go and have open access, we can really use open access to make new forms of science, open science. Thank you.